So our next speaker on stage is going to be Ricardo Dolmetsch. I've known Ricardo for many years now. He's been traveling back and forth between the East Coast and the West Coast. He did his PhD here, then did his postdoc in Boston, then came back as a faculty here in neuroscience. And then he's been recently recruited as the global head of neuroscience at Novartis, so really huge job in Boston. And then Ricardo's research has always been on neuroscience, from calcium signaling to a more disease-based type of research. He's been really interested in neuropsychiatrics and neurodegenerative disease and disorders. And he's been using both genomics and stem cell approaches to try to both model these diseases as well as to discover drugs that could help prevent development of these disorders or revert them. So that's all I'm going to say. I just want to welcome Ricardo on stage. Thanks, Ricardo.
Okay, well, I guess I should start by thanking all of you for being here. I'm going to tell you over the next 10 minutes or so just a little bit about the work we are trying to do to try and develop new treatments for neurodevelopmental disorders. And before I do that, I just want to tell you a little bit about myself and why I do this. There are two facts I should tell you. The first is that I'm originally Colombian, and so what that means is that my mom, who still lives in Colombia, calls me, two or three times a week so that I can provide very expensive and increasingly inaccurate computer advice. In doing this, she drops these great little bits of motherly advice. Okay, the second thing you need to know is that when I started my faculty position at Stanford, I was very interested in biophysics and in trying to understand how electrical activity shaped the developing brain. And I was very happy doing that, and then my son developed autism. And so after that, I changed the direction of my lab to try and understand the underlying basis of autism. So a few weeks ago, my mom called, and she said, I'm amazed at how much progress you're making in autism. Every day you discover something else that causes it. You know, the thing is that if you're the head of neuroscience at a drug company, that's failure. So the question is, why do we fail so much? Why do we fail so much, especially in neuroscience? And in fact, this is from a recent review in Nature Drug Discovery. And it turns out that if you're a big drug company, actually being in neuroscience is negatively correlated with your success. Okay? This of course, has resulted in many big companies exiting neuroscience. And, of course, this is if you think about all of neuroscience. Imagine if I were to tell you that we have never really developed any drugs at all for any neurodevelopmental diseases. So we have no track record. So why is it so hard? This is sort of the process for developing a new drug. You start with disease and target selection, then you go through preclinical modeling and assay development. You then screen, generally, some big library of compounds. You develop an antibody, you optimize it, and then you go into clinical development. And it turns out that for the brain, it's really hard to do this on all fronts. So to begin with, historically, we tend to select diseases we just don't understand very well. And this is because companies like mine really had this mentality that everything had to be a blockbuster. And so we just don't understand autism very well because it's not a single disease. It's a whole bunch of different diseases. We don't really understand depression very well. It's not a single disease either. And so one of the things we have to do is we have to be prepared to narrow down the population so that we can make drugs that have a better chance of success. And one way of doing this is to go for genetically defined disorders. So the second problem is that our preclinical models and assays are really crappy. They're really bad. The problem really has been that we have based a lot of our development on mouse pharmacological models. And it turned out that after billions of dollars, we now know that they don't work. They really do not predict whether your drug is going to work in people. So we need better models. And I should just tell you that drug development is all about models. It's all about assays. because you have to go through many, many rounds of optimization. And the question is, are you optimizing your drug on something that predicts whether it will work in people? And if that assay is bad, then the whole project is doomed. The third problem is that, and this is one of the reasons why it's been harder in neuroscience than in other areas of drug development, which is that, you know, in neuroscience, we often have to make drugs that are really, really safe. You know, and our tolerance for risk has gone down dramatically. And we're often giving these drugs to people for the rest of their lives. And so this turns out to be really difficult. Now, on top of this, we actually have to get things into the brain. I live in continuous envy of my oncology colleagues. I mean, they develop a medicine, and essentially the only requirement is it not dissolve the mouse. Okay, and then they can, with that, they can take it into people. Okay, but we can't do that in neuroscience, and it takes a long time to optimize a molecule in all those different axes. And then the final problem is that our patients, in addition to being really heterogeneous, you know, we have all these clinical endpoints, and they're really hard to measure. So it's mood and attention and memory, and if you had a cup of coffee this morning, that changed everything. If you slept badly, that changed everything. And on top of that, the way we do it is we hire these contract research organizations, and they have psychologists and psychiatrists and neurologists, and they see patients every, you know, 2 or 3 weeks, and then they tell you your patient looks a little bit better, and some of these scales are crazy. They go from a sad face to a happy face, right? That's the level of resolution. And so, of course, it's very difficult to know. Even if you have a good drug, it's very difficult to know if it works. So we have to innovate there. Okay, I'm going to give you two examples where we've taken a different approach. We have decided, instead of going for some huge blockbuster indication, to go for something much narrower. And we're trying to understand that patient population much more carefully. So the first example is something called Philand McDermott syndrome. And Philand McDermott syndrome is a rare but not ultra-rare neurodevelopmental disorder. It's caused by a mutation on chromosome 22 in a region called Q13. And it's really caused by the deletion of this gene called SHANK3, which is a protein that is found in synapses at the postsynaptic density, if you really want to know. And it causes, it's a very severe disease. It's loss of just one copy of this gene, but it causes severe hypotonia, this global developmental delay, absent or severely delayed speech, autism. And the first problem that we faced is we just didn't have any good models, because it turns out that when we made the mouse that had exactly the same mutation, it was a totally normal, happy mouse. Maybe it wasn't if you're another mouse, but if you're a human, it doesn't look any different from any other mouse. And so the problem is that, you know, so how do oncologists solve this? Well, you know, they have like tumor biopsies, and they can study those. We don't have brain biopsies. So we decided that we were going to make one. And so you know, we actually work that I started at Stanford you know, to which many people have contributed, not just my lab, you know, led to the development of this technology that allows us to start with skin cells or blood cells, convert them into stem cells, take those stem cells, and then make them into neurons. And in fact, those neurons are, and if you do this from a very specific individual with a specific mutation, then you end up with neurons that have that mutation. And so we did this. And so this then allows us to not get a biopsy, but make one in the lab. And when we did this, first of all, we can make neurons that look for all the world like the neurons that are in your brain. They fire, you know, action potentials. They make connections with each other. And when we did that for patients that have from Philand McDermott syndrome, we found, and this is now very sciencey here, but let me see how I can point to it. What we found was that there was a very, very severe defect in the ability of these cells to form connections with each other, to form synapses. This is sort of what we thought we were going to see in the mouse, but we never saw. But what this did is it gave us an assay that allowed us to optimize a whole set of molecules. And so we looked, we did screens, we looked for molecules that might allow us to rescue just this defect in just cells from the patient, even though we had no animal model. And it turned out that there's a growth factor called insulin-like growth factor 1 that, in fact, can rescue this defect in cells. Now, in fact, this led to a clinical trial with insulin-like growth factor 1 that just read out, and it was a positive trial. But it turns out that IGF-1 is kind of a terrible drug for the brain. It has a very, very short half-life. It doesn't get into the brain. So we've gone on to make a better version of this. And so this is our newest, best, coolest molecule. These little dots that you see that are synapses in controls. There are lots of synapses in cells from the patients. There are very few of them. And then when we add our drug, suddenly you get many more. So we hope to take this into people. So I have just 1 minute, and in 1 minute, I'm going to rush through this other project. And this is a project for spinal muscular atrophy. And this is the most common genetic cause of infant death. It is a severe, severe disease. It's autosomal recessive, which means that you need two mutations. And it's a loss of the alpha motor neurons that drive your muscles. It's a severe, terrible disorder. There are different degrees there are different kinds, but the neonatal version is particularly terrible. It's caused by a loss of one gene called the SMN1 gene. And it turns out that everybody has another copy of that gene. It's just a little bit bad. It has one mutation, and so it doesn't get properly made, and therefore normally it gets degraded. And so a scientist in our group developed an assay that allowed us to look for drugs that would change that splicing. This is the first time anybody's ever done this. If I came to you and told you, look, you know, I want to start a company, and my company is going to develop small molecules that bind to RNA and change splicing, you would never give me any money. Period. Okay? But it turned out that this is the kind of thing you can do if you're a big company, because there are, you know, other things that will work. And so we did this, and we ended up coming up with a whole series of molecules. And we, in fact, came up with some that very exquisitely changed the splicing of just that gene. And then we put this into mice, and it turns out that it elevates the I should just tell you that in between those two things, there were years of optimizing this molecule, so it was actually safe and got into the brain and did all these things. But ultimately, we put it into the brain of mice, and it turns out to elevate the protein levels. These mouse, in this case, the mouse model actually works. And we can actually get the mice to gain weight. Our drug is called LMI. And we can actually protect mice that normally die. And this drug is about to go into babies this week. So it is an entirely doable thing, even in a fairly short time period. It's just simply that we're not going to treat everybody. We're going to have to go disease, one disease at a time. OK, so with that, let me just tell you one last thing about the final improvement that we need to do, which is we need to figure out how to do better clinical trials. And what that really means is, A, start with diseases we understand. Genetically defined diseases are helpful that way. Two, we need to develop ways of measuring the outcomes in populations that we really understand. And then finally, we need ways of designing better clinical trials. Our clinical trials are designed with sort of 19th century math. And that's not good, because it means that we're very susceptible to things like the placebo effect, which is wonderful once you sell the drug, and great if you're a patient, and terrible if you want to figure out whether your drug does anything or not. Right? So this is where we are. Let me just finish by just showing you that, of course, the one other thing that we do well in industry is we work really, really well in teams. This is, of course, not my work. I just talk about it. This is the work of a whole bunch of people. So thank you.